met the Minister of Transport, Benedict Martins. Well, next to him is the Deputy Minister of Transport, Ms. Sindiswe Chikunga. Thank you very much indeed for joining us and welcome to the programme. We have the Director General for Transport, Mr. George Mahlalela. Thank you very much indeed for joining us, sir. We also have Ms. Hamida Fakira, who's the Deputy Director General Maritime. Thank you for joining us on the program, and somebody that you may have seen when we've wished away the SA Agulhas often on the program, Commander Tsietsi Mukele, who's the CEO of SA Maritime Safety Authority. Thank you very much indeed for joining us. All right, so to all of you, welcome. There's so much to talk about. I'm not quite sure where to start, but I think because there's a maritime bias perhaps on the panel, and also because it's something that you've highlighted as an important year. Let me start with you, Minister, maybe. Why should we be paying attention to the maritime sector? I think most people, especially some of us who live inland, it's not something that we think we're involved in or affects us, does it?
There's a great potential from the maritime sector. It's virtually untapped in this country. There are a number of resources to be found in the sea. Minerals, diamonds, oil. In this particular sector, the commander will tell you that South Africa does not have ships that fly under our flag. There are many countries who do business with South Africa, but the ships merely come here to deliver goods, pick up goods, and return to their respective countries. South Africa does not have its own ships register.
Why is that, Minister?
It's an area that we need to develop to get private enterprise interested in this area. There are career opportunities. Engineering, shipbuilding, a number of disciplines to be learnt through the shipping industry. So it opens up many job opportunities and career paths that have been presently untapped. So our youngsters, it does not mean if they are based in inland provinces, they cannot acquire the skills that are to be obtained from the maritime industry.
Okay.
I've brought Commander here and the Deputy Director General because they are very passionate about this. And this is our theme for the next year, to focus on this untapped potential that South Africa has.
All right, well, let's talk to you, Hamida. What would you say are the biggest issues that you're having to deal with in your office as the Deputy DG Maritime?
I think one of the biggest issues is that awareness, creating awareness out there about all of the opportunities which exist in the maritime transport industry. It is something which is seen as far away, it's in the sea, it's not talked about as road, you know. You just jump into the taxi and you go to your home or you get into your car. It's not seen as close to people. But in effect, it is in actual fact estimated that the potential earnings of that market is about 34 billion rand of ships that ride around our coast. So that there is a lot that we could tap on. And also the other thing is to make people understand that the maritime industry is not just about seafarers. It's not just about sailors on a ship. It's much broader than that. For instance, insurance brokering, knowing about the safety law, international law, which is very important when you have to sail ships all around the world. You have to understand all of the international convention. And then another one is about just the financing, the funding of the industry. And also making people understand that you don't necessarily need to own a ship to transport cargo. It's very easy nowadays to just charter a vessel or to rent space on a car, on a vessel, which is actually much cheaper. And the other aspects is the way the industry is unbundled. okay? You don't have one single country which does the entire value chain of a shipping operation. You might have an owner who's in Germany, is financed with a bank in Switzerland, the ship is built in South Korea, the crew is from Philippines, the fueling is from Nigeria, and then cargo is from all over the world, of course. So this is basically how disaggregated, multinationally, this industry is. So making South Africans, especially the entrepreneur, understand this is actually one of my major tasks currently.
All right, okay, so you've got a huge in-tray. For all of this to happen, it has to be a safe industry as well. Commander Mkele, what is the role of the Maritime Safety Authority, and what are the issues that you are dealing with? Piracy, I'm sure, might be something that's there as well.
Thanks so much, Peter, to you and the viewers. The issue that I want to start with, just as a big ticket item on the maritime sector, is that up until now, we, even before looking at opportunities, we have to deal with the issues of national sovereignty. And those issues are that South Africa as a country owns an exclusive economic zone, three times larger than the land size of the country. And it remains unclaimed because it's not seen as an industrial hub. It houses oil and gas, houses diamond mining, it houses tourism, houses pharmaceutical industries, renewables going forward. So we need to be working very hard, and that's where SAMHSA is coming from, in getting our waters to be proclaimed as the 10th province of the country, so that then it receives the attention administratively and otherwise that would give to any other province, so that we can exploit that. The second issue is that with next year being the 20th anniversary of our democracy, we'd know that 1902, end of the Anglo-Boer War, what happened? Coastal provinces, state, non-South African part, Transvaal and the Free State were integrated in. Comes 1994, we still have a responsibility of decolonizing the maritime space, so that on the basis of that, we can then say, how can we then build a thriving industry that will pull our country out of where it's at now? Thank you.
All right, thank you very much indeed, Commander Mkele. All right, so that's maritime. We've touched on that, and we're going to unpack everything quite a bit, but just to introduce some of the other topics, Deputy Minister Chikunga, if I could just put to you, towards part of the speech that the minister addressed is road safety, and I think that's something that's very close to everybody at home. And I just get a feeling that we're not winning the battle. What is it about South Africans? What is it that we need to change? What do you need to do to get rid of this scourge, as the minister described it?
Thank you, Peter. I think the first thing that we need to change as South Africans is our attitude. Because I think that is what is actually responsible for so many accidents on our roads. Everybody that is driving a vehicle has got a license, I take it, and a learner's license for that matter. And therefore, they know the rules of the road. But we go all out to make people aware of what is lying ahead of them as they go or as they drive on our roads. But they will still drink, they will still speed, they will still overtake dangerously, they will still drive even when they know they are exhausted. And therefore, we have all these fatalities. So the first thing is for us to change and know that those traffic laws that are put for us to observe, if we don't, we're committing crime. And therefore, we become criminals. When you overtake on a barrier line, you are actually committing crime. And therefore, you are a criminal. Mm-hmm. I think these are the issues. And I think we've done a lot to try and make people aware of this. But still it happens. No country can afford to have 1,000 people dying every month. No country can afford to have 40 people dying every day. No country can afford that. And equally, we can't afford it as South Africa. We can't afford it as families. We can't afford it as communities. Because it actually takes away our breadwinners, our children, our parents and everybody. And I think it is in this spirit that the minister is actually calling upon all of us, because it can't be the Department of Transport alone. It can't be the government alone. Of course, we've got to provide leadership. However, it calls on all of us to observe this and ensure that we are safe on our roads.
Deputy Minister, isn't it about, because, you know, the children in a playground, if they're not supervised, they will misbehave. That's our natural tendency. Is it not the enforcing that's a problem more than, you know, instead of appealing to good sense of human nature, which I'm afraid has proved time and time again, isn't it about enforcement, spending more resources, more time and more effort in the resources in enforcing these laws? Because they are good laws.
Indeed, it's a combination of all that, Peter. It's law enforcement, which I think it should play an important role. But also it's us, it's me as a driver who gets into my car. It's me who, when I park my car, I immediately become a pedestrian. And I must know now that I'm, in fact, I must know that I'm now playing a role of a pedestrian, and I must know where to walk along the road. And as I get into my car, I become a driver. I must know how to drive, when to overtake, and when to switch on my lights, and when to do whatever, not to drink on the road, I mean, when I'm going to drive. So it's a combination of all those things. Law enforcement, I agree fully, we've got to enforce law. If people are committing crimes on our roads, they've got to be arrested, they must be convicted. If they must be sent to jail, they must go to jail. We've got to do that. And I think we are doing it in a way. As I said at some stage, just this year, I mean, during the festive season, we stopped about 1.2 million vehicles. And of those, we issued about 500,000 tickets. And of the 500,000 tickets, about 5,000 tickets, about 400 or so, yeah, they were for drunken driving. This is the problem.
Okay, now I'm going to bring in the deputy, the DG. Isn't the issue that we only do this during the festive periods? Isn't this something we should be doing all the time? Shouldn't we have mobile courts throughout the year? Shouldn't we be stopping vehicles throughout the year and jailing people throughout the year? DG?
Yes, I think it's important that it's an annual program. And I think the minister has stated that even when we were giving out the accident statistics in January, that it would be a campaign throughout the year. And that is happening. I mean, the enforcement plan, we are reporting on it on a monthly basis. The various metropolis are actually having enforcement. So it has to take place throughout the year, and we think that it will help to sustain the campaign and to ensure that the consciousness of our people is up there in partnership with government on this matter.
Minister?
I would like to respond to the issue that you raised with regard to visible policing. I agree that there's a need for more visible policing. I would also like to remind you that over the festive season, just under 18,000 traffic officers were deployed over the festive period. It can't be correct that as a nation, we have mechanical discipline. We only do the correct thing if there's a policeman on every corner. The challenge for us as a nation,
but Minister, that's
is
human
to
nature.
Internalize.
That's human nature. That's how people do. They will get away with what they can get away with. And in fact,
we have to move from that.
Minister, from my own experience, I know usually what time of the month, where the traffic officers are going to be. And once you've gone past that point, you're a free agent. You can misbehave until the cows come home. And so I'm saying,
Peter, on this one, I can't agree with you.
No, but it's true.
I acknowledge that there are people who behave in that manner. But you also have to acknowledge that they may be in the minority, but there are people who conscientiously follow the rules of the road. That is the ethos that we have to encourage as a nation. We can't just say that on each and every street corner there must be a policeman if there's no policeman, there'll be anarchy in this country. It can't be the correct template that we put forward for our country.
So how do you change the mindset?
The mindset that we change, we have programs in place from primary school, from high school. Last year in the Eastern Cape, more than 239 high school students passed, obtained valid driver's licenses. You have to inculcate this awareness in that core of people. What we are also encouraging is learnerships at primary school, so that children from an early age can imbibe issues pertaining to road safety, so that it becomes second nature,
Minister,
like brushing your teeth.
You really have a lot of faith in humanity, and my experience isn't quite the same. 5 o'clock, I'm trying to go down a particular road, and as soon as there's traffic buildup, Deputy Minister, maybe you can address this. As soon as there's traffic buildup, I see taxi drivers driving down emergency lanes and driving down the wrong lane in the face of oncoming traffic. And you stand still wondering, what on earth is he doing? But they seem to do this every single day. They don't care.
But we can't leave that to become a norm. We have to fight it.
That's why I'm saying the enforcement isn't there, Deputy Minister.
I think, Peter, over and above what the Minister has said, that is why we have structures such as SANDACO to work with at national level, so that they assist us with the taxi industry, because surely we will not be everywhere. We will not be everywhere where there is a taxi on the road. But they are there to say to their drivers, this is what you are supposed to do. We have already have put legislations and regulations in place. The speed limit, for instance, for taxis will be 100 kilometers per hour, whether on a freeway or wherever. We've said that. Some are observing it, but others are still not. And that is why we are therefore on continuous interaction with such structures like SANDACO, for instance, and LTA or LTA, for instance, to say, please assist us to ensure that your drivers are properly trained, that your drivers observe the law on the road, and that your drivers do not take their passengers as objects, but they know that they are family members, they come from families, they are breadwinners, they go to work every day, they depend on this transport, they are poor, many of them, they are women, many of them, they are children going to school, many of them, and they still have their future ahead of them. All and right. That is why we work with them.
I have to take a quick break, but just before we do that, DG, perhaps corruption, I think, is part of the equation here. And the reason why these guys, and a lot of people actually, misbehave is because they know that there's a process that they can follow and their charges will disappear, or they'll just give some money for a Coke and it's sorted. How do we deal with that?
Well, we have structures in government specifically dealing with corruption within the enforcement services. Even within the Road Traffic Management Corporation, provincial departments have special units dealing with that. It's a big challenge. I think all of us agree that people are faced with that situation. I mean, you have one or two traffic cops, and no one is able to see what's happening there. But I think the important point, and I think that's what the minister was saying, unless we see this as a collective effort by all of us, because you have that enforcement officer who's asking for a bribe, and you have someone who's providing that bribe. So as society, if all of us are saying, well, enough is enough, this is a huge challenge, let's deal with it. Yes, we will try and ensure that we deal with corruption. But at the end of the day, it is about partnership from all of us. And that's the only way we can succeed in this.
All right. Well, we're certainly going to engage with the viewers at home and also with our guests that are here after this break. And don't forget, it's not just about roads. Air is another issue. And the maritime sector in particular is also in sharp focus in the department this year. So stay with us, and we'll be back right after this.